The Indian River Lagoon stretches through five coastal counties and is the heart of the Treasure Coast. It is home to more than 3,000 species of plants and animals, including 35 listed on the threatened or endangered list, more than any other water body in North America. But over the last 100 years, the impacts of more than 1.6 million people living along this estuary has increased the amount of freshwater runoff and nutrients flowing into this fragile ecosystem. Through this six-part series, we'll hear from scientists, researchers, and government officials who will provide a better understanding of the history of the lagoon, the problems impacting it, and offer solutions to improve the water quality along the Indian River Lagoon and its tributaries. So dive in as we listen to the water.
All right. Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Howard Tipton, and I have the privilege of serving as your county administrator for St. Lucie County. And this evening, we are resuming our series of Listen to the Water. We talk about a lot of things in my office that are important every day. We talk about economic development. We talk about affordable housing, working with veterans. We talk about how are we working with our schools and higher education institutions. We talk about extending the Mets lease so that we can have them here for spring training for many more years to come. But I think at the end of the day, the conversations and the time that we spend talking about our environment, and in particular the water, are some of the most important conversations that we have. Because I don't think we get judged on whether or not we leave our economy in great shape, because it's something that's subject to so many different variables. Just like the Mets could decide after 20 years to go somewhere else. But this land that we've inherited is what we pass on. This is really what our legacy is about. And so it's really an honor to have this conversation and to have such distinguished speakers sharing different perspectives on our environment, and in particular as we're talking about our water, because it is something that, as I look out and as we grow and think about growing by 160,000 more people in just 25 more years, some really tremendous growth. Is it easier to fix this problem now and start to get our hands around it, or do we want to wait and make it really impossible? And so it's important. There needs to be a sense of urgency, and I appreciate you being here. So I mentioned that this is a resumption. We had two excellent presentations from Dr. Grant Gilmore and Dr. Edie Witter in our first two installments, and then we were disrupted by Hurricane Matthew for a couple of weeks. And believe me when I say that I'm using the word disrupted in a grateful way, because I could be talking about it from a devastating or destroying perspective, but instead we were just disrupted, and that's okay. So we resume our presentations tonight with the view from several St. Lucie County staff members. Following tonight, the series continues with Dr. Dwayne DeVries, who's the Executive Director of the Indian River Lagoon Council and National Estuary Program, and that'll be next Tuesday on the 26th of October. We have Wayne Mills, who will join us on November the 2nd, who, as the chairman of the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, helped to bring the critical water body back from the brink of collapse. And finally, Dr. Brian LaPointe on November the 16th. So we've had to slide the schedule a little bit here. He'll be talking to us from his perspective on the impacts of the more than 300,000 septic tanks that are in the five-county area on our waterways, and in particular the Indian River Lagoon. The updated dates or schedules can be found on the materials here at the front of the desk. And as a reminder, all of the lectures in this series will be broadcast on SLC TV, or can be watched at your leisure online at www.stluceco.gov/listen-to-the-water. So with that, I have the pleasure of introducing two young gentlemen to you this evening who are part of our county team. And then when they're finished, you will get to hear a little bit more from me, and then Ed Skvarch, who's our extension director. So with that, let me introduce both of these gentlemen to you. Patrick Dayan is our Water Quality Division Manager. He grew up in South Florida and migrated to the Treasure Coast in 2005. He graduated with a BS in Ocean Engineering from Florida Atlantic University. He's got over 14 years of engineering experience working in both public and private sector positions. His experience includes land and hydrographic surveying, land development design and permitting, storm water regulation enforcement, construction inspection, project and contract management. He's a licensed professional engineer and registered stormwater inspector. He currently manages the Water Quality Division, which is a staff of 9 interdisciplinary personnel whose mission is to manage county stormwater systems to prevent flooding and property damage and to protect water quality for the safety and enjoyment of the citizens of our community. And I always liked that they didn't really call it stormwater. They call it water quality. And I think the distinction and the focus is important. So that's Patrick. After Patrick, you're going to hear from Mike Middlebrook. He's our natural resources manager. Mike is graduated from the University of North Florida with a Bachelor of Science degree in biology with an emphasis on Florida ecology and genetics. He's a product of the Florida public land acquisition movement of the early 1990s and was immersed in land acquisition programs such as Florida Forever and Florida Communities Trust at an early age. While still in school, Mike joined the City of Jacksonville's Preservation Project, which preserves the largest urban park system in the United States. Over the past 10 years, Mike has managed a combined 70,000 acres of Florida's public land system from North to South Florida and has worked for a multitude of land management programs, including the City of Jacksonville, St. Lucie County, and Broward County. Mike assists the Board of County Commissioners in managing the county's 10,000 acres in conservation lands and provides planning and guidance on a wide array of initiatives such as invasive species management, prescribed fire, habitat restoration, enhancement, and passive recreation. And so with that, I would ask you to please welcome first Patrick Dayan.
Good evening. Thank you, Howard, for that introduction. Thank you, Sandra, for putting on this wonderful conversation series. I did have the opportunity to watch both of our previous presenters, and if you haven't yet, please go to the county's YouTube site where you can see those. They're quite riveting, to say the least. Thanks to all of you for attending tonight. I know many of us are very busy in our lives, so we thank you for taking the opportunity to listen to our story. So we came up with the name Beyond Triage, and I thought that was a very appropriate name because when we think about triage, we're really talking about the categorization and the systematic ranking of our most critical needs. And this becomes primarily important when you have a lack of resources, which many of our local county governments, local cities, and other municipalities are truly facing. I'll give you a brief overview of our presentation. If we stick with the medical kind of theme of triage, which I always think of, we'll talk about what you talk about at the doctor's office, your family history. We might talk about some of our lifestyle choices. These would be our commitments and our local water quality successful efforts. We'll talk about some of the goals that we have in the future, including the component that Mike will talk to you about. We'll talk about some of our day-to-day lifestyles as well, our operations, our daily routine. We'll talk about some outside aids that we might pull in if you have a dietitian or maybe a fitness trainer that helps you out. And as we end all of these conversation series, we'll have a call to action where we can discuss some of the small changes that we can make in our daily lives to help our natural systems. I'd be remiss if we didn't mention what is probably fresh on everybody's mind and certainly garnered the bulk of the media attention this summer. This photo was taken in Central Marine and Stewart in June of this year. This is a cyanobacteria or blue-green algae bloom in full blossom. And it was not just a visual sight, as Dr. Witter mentioned, but also a feast for all the senses. My home is a little bit about a mile away from this particular area, and I can tell you when I was walking the dogs and the wind was blowing out of the south, I could smell it when I was walking outside. It's important to note that this isn't the first time this has occurred. In 2013, we had what was dubbed the Lost Summer due to similar blooms, and in 1998, which was another El Nino year, very warm, very wet, we had a lot of blue-green algae blossoms that also affected our fish and our natural areas in the North Fork and South Fork. And we're not the only part of the country that's experiencing this. Lake Erie, for example, up north, is also going through massive problems with cyanobacteria. So We have scientists that are studying the toxicity of these organisms and trying to determine how that impacts our natural systems. We know they're photosynthetic organisms, so just like all plants, they thrive on an adequate food supply, sunlight, and time. And we're all working on the source of the food. Could it be agriculture? Could it be septic tanks? Could it be urban runoff? Sources really point to all of the above for the time being. So how did we get here? Well, first and foremost, Florida was plumbed to drain efficiently, all about flood control, as Howard has dubbed it, Florida on the cheap. There was very little attention paid to storage of water for environmental purposes. We have a lot more population that are additionally taxing our natural systems. And we have infrastructure that is nearing or approaching the end of its usable lifespan. This is a drainage map showing how the area was originally plumbed. And you can see the four dark lines that are coming off of Lake Okeechobee. Those are the Hillsborough, New River, Miami, and West Palm Canal, primarily to drain Lake Okeechobee and to drain the Everglades. In 1919, we had two drainage districts that started work on the western parts of St. Lucie County. We'll talk about that a little bit further. In 1925, the St. Lucie Canal was completed. This is a C-44 canal. That's the one that goes into Lake Okeechobee and brings the water to tide here. This is primarily, it was done for flood control and for navigational purpose and commerce to send the goods from our eastern portion over to areas on the west coast of Florida. It's important to note that this was the only canal dug completely in uplands, which is kind of an interesting note. Now, in the 20s, Florida went through a series of hurricanes, as are well documented, with floods out in the southern portions of Lake Okeechobee, Belglade, and areas like that that had tremendous loss of life and loss of property. And in 1947, we had what's dubbed the Big Flood. This is when over 100 inches of rain fell in the southern parts of Florida, including having, in a span of 25 days, two hurricanes and a tropical storm. It created so much devastation that it actually had enough support by the legislature to create what was called the Central and South Florida Flood Control District, which later became renamed the South Florida Water Control District, or Water Management District, as we know it today. And in 1948, the Central and South Florida Project was authorized by Congress to establish a perimeter levee to keep the eastern portions of South Florida dry, establish an Everglades agricultural area, which was about 25% of very, very fertile lands that were drained for agriculture, and also for the water conservation areas to our south. This is a slide that is pulled from weekly phone calls that we have with the Army Corps of Engineers that help them determine how much water to move out of Lake Okeechobee and in which direction to move it. You can see there's a lot of information on here. So they've gotten better at managing this system with monitors, gauges, operational schedules, weirs, and monitors like that, but it still remains in a large state of distress. If we think about Lake Okeechobee, it's a 750 square mile reservoir that drains 5,000 square miles of land. So an inch of rain north of the lake equals 4 inches of rain in the lake itself. If we look at our local areas, a lot of you may be familiar with this, but our main water courses are the sea canals that were dug in the 60s. So it's a C-25, which empties out into Taylor Creek near the mouth of the Fort Pierce Inlet. We have the C-24 canal, which is south of Port St. Lucie Boulevard, and the C-23 canal, which is located on the St. Lucie and Martin County line. We also have input from our natural areas and our municipal areas, as well as 10 Mile Creek that goes into the North Fork. And we have the South Fork that empties in through the C-44 canal into the estuary. A presentation that I visited at Harbor Branch indicated that about 92% of the water from the South Fork does exit to tide at the St. Lucie Inlet. And of course, we have those two inlets. We're very fortuitous to have those two inlets with the semi-diurnal flushing. So twice a day, we get that influx of fresh seawater that helps keep our Indian River Lagoon, the healthiest portion of the Indian River Lagoon in our five counties. However, our river is still under a very large state of distress. Taking a look at our local areas. Again, this is a color-coded map showing the major water courses in our area. We all know about the city of Port St. Lucie and the city of Fort Pierce, but what may not be so well known is that we have two 298 districts. They're called 298 because that is the portion of the Florida statutes that's established that gives them the authority to exist and to tax. And that is Fort Pierce Farms Water Management District and North St. Lucie River Water Control District, and those are indicated in the blue and in the green on this exhibit. They control about 120 square miles, so something about the size of the city of Port St. Lucie, and 250 miles of canal. They are major players in surface water management in St. Lucie County. There's a wonderful report that was written by a local engineer named Dick Hellstrom in 1991 that really talks about the way that these districts were formed, and they diked off a perimeter. They cut canals on half-mile intervals for you surveyors out there. That's so that every 40-acre tract or every quarter-quarter section could have canal frontage in order to utilize, and they started taxing. And in areas of high rain events, they would actually have people that would go out there and try to use dynamite to blow holes in these dikes. And in order to counteract that, they would deputize people on horseback and have them ride the perimeter of these dikes and shoot first and ask questions later is basically how it used to be. This was truly the Wild Wild West. This is a photo taken showing South Hutchinson Island and State Road A1A under construction. You can see the downtown Fort Pierce there in the upper left part of the photo. And in particular, you know, you see a Bear Point and Middle Cove here. And the attention to efficiency that was laid out by the construction of State Road A1A here is quite dramatic. And it's a lack of understanding of the ecological benefit of putting a roadway through, an estuarine environment that is really a challenge for the local stewards now of these systems to undo. This is a historic aerial of the River Park area. For those of you who are familiar with the area, it's the southern portions of the county and the eastern portions of the city of Port St. Lucie. You can see that there was very little development. The Serpentine North Fork is coming down through the middle of there. We've overlaid the roadway network that exists there today. And you can see, save for a small agricultural piece here coming off of US-1, I don't know if this mouse is gonna work for me, there we go. There was very little development and our areas here were quite wet. Mike has some tremendous aerials he'll share with you later on in the presentation, but I wanted to point that out. By and large, at this time, the only real true works of drainage in the county were happening out west in 1919. Now we're moving forward to 30 years later. It's important to note this time in snapshot because in 1972 is when the Water Resources Act was passed, and this was the first time that environmental aspects were actually taken into account and thought about in surface water planning. So we're trying to undo this amount of development with our regulations for stormwater management today. And of course, moving forward, is what the area looked like about 7 years ago. But note that we have, by and large, conserved our riverfront areas. And this is a testament to the vision that our leaders had to make us look very, very different than the urban areas down south. I grew up in South Florida. I was a benefactor of that Central and South Florida project. And I can tell you that it does not look like this in downtown Fort Lauderdale. So it's something to note of distinction. Howard mentioned the additional population that we're going to have. This is a snapshot taken from University of Florida study that indicates we're going to have 160,000 new people. That's the city of Port St. Lucie here in the next 25 years. So when we think about natural systems and how we're going to serve that population, we have to think about drinking water, surface water, and wastewater, all of the above in addition to our roadway network and other infrastructure. So as engineers, we're charged with balancing the needs of attenuation, holding back water for water quality, and discharging water for flood protection. And it truly is a delicate balance. So we're charged with trying to prevent water from entering the system so that our natural areas can maintain their health and with the discharge of water for large storm events. The two photos on the right were taken during Tropical Storm Fay. It dropped over 27 inches of rain in Melbourne. Of course, you can't plan or build for these kinds of events, but we do have standards in place that dictate the storms that you would design for your roadways and your finished floor elevations for homes and for streets and parking lots. Excuse me one second. I mentioned the systems at the end of their usable lifespan. These are photos of corrugated metal pipes of various age that are on our county roadways. Some are public, some are private. One of the engineers at the water management district has a saying that I like. Flooding doesn't happen when water comes. Flooding happens when water doesn't leave. And when you get to a point where your infrastructure is collapsed and failing, that introduces sediment into your water flow areas and holds back water and creates some real challenges for the systems themselves. So how do we treat these? It depends on who's the owner and who's the maintaining responsibility, but I can share with you that in some of our older neighborhoods, you probably can't drive up or down one of the blocks without having a pipe that looks in some form like one of the ones you see here today. We also have challenges from non-native species. I am no biologist, but on the top there you have water lettuce, and on the bottom you have hydrilla. These plants are excellent at pulling nutrients out of the water course. They're also excellent at plugging up our water systems and reducing the level of service that we need from them. Some methods of dealing with them are mechanical removal, which is quite costly, or herbicide application, which has its own drawbacks as well. So taking a larger picture at our area in specific, what are some of our problems? Well, our nutrient concentration drop for drop is far in excess in nitrogen and phosphorus than the Lake Okeechobee runoff. We also have more water from our area entering the estuary and the river than Lake Okeechobee. We have many older neighborhoods with direct discharges that still remain and no attenuation. This causes damages to our filter feeders, our seagrasses, and our oysters, and also to businesses. Health advisories, when posted by the Department of Health, create some very bad press for us. We have a tremendous maintenance funding shortfall. We can't pave our roads, we can't replace our pipes, and we have a lot of challenges on how we're even going to do new things, far less maintain what we already have. And then we have BMAP compliance, which I'll expand on a little bit more. BMAP stands for Basin Management Action Plan, but this is a unfunded state mandate passed on to the local governments to deal with. This is another graphic indicating our major flow areas or basins. And they have two numbers there. One is the amount of water that's flowing from each of these, which is acre feet, and then they have the amount of tons of phosphorus. So if you look at, for example, coming out of Lake Okeechobee, you see that 414,000 acre feet and 96 tons, that ratio is about 1 in 4. If you were looking at the C23, for example, you'd see that 153,000 acre feet and 91 tons. So almost as much phosphorus in about one-third of the water, again, leading to the concentration that I spoke to before. Again, thanks for the South Florida Water Management for these graphics. Green is good, red is bad. On the left there, you see the phosphorus concentrations, and you can tell that in our particular area that St. Lucie County, the western portions by and large, are the greatest impairment for phosphorus. And on the right, you see nitrogen, which you see over 90% of our area is really impaired for nitrogen. So these led to the creation of a Basin Management Action Plan. There's 29 of these in Florida, and they basically designate whenever a water body is impaired for various different forms of nutrients. Here we have phosphorus, nitrogen, biological oxygen demand. There's a statewide BMAP for mercury. These are goals that everybody's required to meet. You have an allocation, you have to do reductions, and you meet those by doing projects. There's a 15-year timeline, so it's defined. There is an endpoint. There's 5-year checkpoints by which required reductions are needed to be met. And it's important to note that for our BMAP, it assumes that Lake Okeechobee, one of our contributors, does meet its own Basin Management Action Plan and its TMDLs. The TMDL is another great acronym that we throw around all the time. It's Total Maximum Daily Load. And what it really speaks to is the way that stormwater management has evolved. The old way of treating stormwater was you treat the first flush or the first inch of rain. The thought was 80% of rain events are less than 1 inch. So if you capture 80% of those rain events, you'll capture 80% of the suspended solids. And now what we're really talking about is a prescriptive type of methodology where any new development has to prove through a pretty complicated set of calculations that its pre-development and its post-development nutrient loading remain the same. Now, these two numbers that are up here, these are concentrations for phosphorus and nitrogen. That's the end goal in 2028. That's where our waters have to be. They're not there today. And they don't, when I think of milligrams per liter, it doesn't mean too much to me, but if we think about 80 parts per billion for phosphorus in particular, we're talking about a half a teaspoon in a typical residential swimming pool. So these are lofty goals, they're admirable goals, but they're very, very difficult and costly. And what this forces locals to do is prioritize or triage which projects they can do that will gain them the most reduction. It's been mentioned before in other presentations that our county commission and our leadership has truly taken a very strong role in water quality. We've done dozens of projects, millions of dollars. We partner with people. I like to think of it as paying for the sins of the past with the price of progress. This graphic shows our wish list of projects, if you will. Those two large areas in the green and white stripes are the two planned reservoirs as a component of the Indian River Lagoon South federal projects. Those are really the ones that, when they're built, will have the most meaningful reduction in the phosphorus and the nitrogen that come out of our two basins, the 23 and 24, and flow into our river. We also have some of the proposed preserve projects like Teague Hammock, Becker Preserve, and the North County Preserves up there. And then we have some St. Lucie County stormwater projects. Some of these have been on our capital improvement project list for some time awaiting funding. Others are some new initiatives that we would hope to accomplish if the infrastructure sales tax would be successful in November. So I'll talk about some of the successes that we've had. The first one is the Indian Hills Recreation Area. This is off of Savannah Road, just east of US 1. It's by the Public Works compound for the city of Fort Pierce, for those of you who are familiar with it, near Heathcote Gardens. This is truly a story of innovation, of partnership, and of creating amenities for the neighborhood. We had six different BMPs, that stands for Best Management Practices, that's methods of dealing with stormwater. The alum injection plant that was installed there is now our third operational alum injection plant. Alum is a flocculant that, when injected into stormwater, helps to coagulate particles and drop them out of suspension. But the best thing about this project was the floating vegetation mats. You can see them on Google Earth. They're fantastic. If you look down at the lake overview there, for a long time, stormwater requirements have made planted littoral zones a condition of permitting. But the dirty secret is that if you put a plant in the water course and you leave it there and you never harvest it out of the water course, when it falls over and dies, it releases all the nutrients that it uptook right back into the water. These floating vegetation mats have plugs in them that are harvested once a year and moved out and be used for compost or for other garden areas, and then replanted with seedlings such that you can actually pull those out of the water course. The city of Fort Pierce has done a magnificent job of creating a exercise trail around the perimeter of the lake, so it really has become an amenity, and that's one of the things that St. Lucie County is focusing on as well, where it's appropriate, if we can involve some passive recreation and really create public amenities out of our stormwater sites rather than just a pond that does the cleansing, that's two for one in my mind. I'll touch briefly on the Port of Fort Pierce. Obviously adjacent to the Indian River Lagoon. We've had over $7 million of improvements, very old infrastructure there, a lot of polluted areas from previous activities that we were cleaning up as part of this project. And it's important to note that this is a key component for growth in our area. Port of Fort Pierce is one of 15 in the state, so that is a huge economic advantage for our area and one that should definitely be looked upon as a key component of our strategy. Getting into our neighborhood retrofit projects, this is Harmony Heights. This is an area, like a lot of other areas in St. Lucie County, that were platted and developed largely in the 50s and 60s before stormwater requirements came to be. So there's unpaved roads, no attenuation, no swales, and it happens to border two major canals, Fort Pierce Farms Canal 1 and the C-25 Canal. The county has completed the first phase of construction, and we have the second phase shovel ready, plans, permits, everything in hand, and we hope to seek the funding to do that, again, through a potential source being the infrastructure sales tax. The county has also constructed multiple baffle boxes. These are hardened concrete items with a weir that you can see here in the bottom, which helps to capture your grass clippings, trash, vegetative matter, and other sediments, and pull those out of suspension prior to discharge into the water body. This one happens to be located near to where that historic aerial, the river park area that I showed you. We also have several on Indian River Drive, and we have one that is currently under design and partnership with the city of Fort Pierce at the exit of their Indian Hills golf course. Citrocamus Preserve was recently completed. This is in the south end of White City. This is a very low-lying area, homes that sometimes their elevations are at or near the road crown elevations. So we had a lot of flooding in this area and created a 4-acre pond to deal with that. This was purchased with a Florida Communities Trust grant back in 2002 and built with our in-house construction crew. And that's a big part of the reason for the savings of more than 50% over the originally estimated cost. And this is also the site for our pilot project, which I'll touch on a little bit later. Platts Creek. This is a magnificent project that was completed last year. There you see it in the 1990s, 100-acre citrus grove, high fertilizer rates, intense use, directly adjacent to the North Fork, probably not the best idea. So in the 90s, the county was fortunate enough to receive a grant to buy the land and develop it into a stormwater treatment site. In 2008, the county created the pump station and wet detention pond. We added another alum injection facility in 2010 with the thought of creating a mitigation bank to sell credits for mitigation to developers. There was only one problem, the timing. 2010 did not really bode very well for selling mitigation credits, so the project went dormant for about 3 years. So in 2013, the city of Port St. Lucie had a project that they needed mitigation credits to offset. We had a site, they had cash, and we completed Platts Creek, which is a magnificent site of 48 acres of habitat that I can tell you the local Audubon Society did their Christmas bird count out there last year, and they were floored by the amount and the diversity of birds that have already flocked to a site that is not even a year old in its habitat. So as Howard said at the groundbreaking, this is an overnight success, 20 years in the making, starting with the purchase of the land in the 90s. Paradise Park is yet another one of our neighborhood improvement projects. You can see its proximity to the Indian River Lagoon there, about a quarter mile away, also on two major water courses. This one is near and dear to my heart because I happened to be working on it when I was a design engineer at a firm before I came to the county. So we've had the fortunate aspect of completing three of the phases. Phase four is currently under construction with the in-house construction crew, and we've just begun design on the fifth phase and final phase for this project. You can see on the top left there, the roadways that used to just flow unabated into the nearby Canal 1. We've now installed dry detention areas to help capture and treat and detain that stormwater prior to release. And on the bottom right, you see the overall neighborhood. The green areas represent the parcels that the county acquired for stormwater treatment. Indian River Estates. This is a large subdivision, again, built early on prior to stormwater regulations, and had the additional challenge of backing up to the Savannah State Preserve, which in the 90s, the state determined that the savannas were overdrained and they started holding back more water, which caused additional pressures on that neighborhood. They placed operable flood control structures in one of the main outfalls, but this was not enough to relieve the burden on the neighborhood. So an ambitious plan was hatched to pump stormwater from the northern end of the neighborhood to a site in the savannas. Here you see some of the timelines from 2008 when the first pump station was constructed to the recently completed main drainage backbone. We still have some challenges with some of the internal blocks there due to driveway culverts and the like, but we hope to solicit the local population to really do their part and step up now that the county has spent over $14 million in this location to help that area truly regain its drainage capacity. This is the pump station discharge. This is a four-pump station, and all told, its capacity is 30,000 gallons per minute, which would empty your backyard swimming pool in about 20 seconds. It pumps up to the wet detention pond on the north side of Midway Road in the Savannah's Preserve, and it does have an alum injection facility there for additional removal of nutrients and a diesel backup generator, being that it's a flood control project as well. Dr. Witter made a pretty good mention of muck in her presentation and how this legacy load really contributes to the phosphorus and the nitrogen that's out there in our natural areas. Mechanical dredging is one of the means to remove this. It has the benefits of creating more capacity, creating better navigation, and allows for seagrass to propagate. Fortunately, it's extremely expensive and time-consuming as far as permitting standpoint. Also, the credit that you receive for doing mechanical dredging and removing muck really is on a case-by-case scenario, because it depends on what they call the nutrient flux of that particular muck. But you can see the phases 1 through 3 that the county completed, totaling over $8 million in improvements. This is a hydraulic dredge at the top left. These machines can't pump the material very, very far. They're limited in capacity as far as that goes. So you have to pump it to a interstitial site, which then you would pick up and remove with a mechanical excavator, put it in dump trucks, and move it to another location. So you can see why the costs kind of build up fairly quickly on a dredging type of project. There was also some shoreline stabilization that took place. The bottom left picture there is the back of the Publix on US 1 near Seaway Drive. And you can see that the bank was falling in there, so seawall and riprap system was put in place so that we could have less maintenance and protection of private property. This is the dredge material site that was completed as a component of that construction, and this will allow us in the future to pump the material in there and then remove it when it's a more opportune time for the county to do so. And this has a very sophisticated system to keep all the sediment, which is silt and clays and the colloidal kind of material that stays in suspension, in that area prior to discharging while still allowing the water to come out. Our Army of One, Mr. Jim Oppenborn, runs our oyster reef and artificial reef program. Jim has been tremendously successful in pulling down and administering grants from various sources. I can't say enough about his ability to solicit volunteers of all sorts from our community and really use this as a teaching moment for young and old. There's that saying up there, or the adult oyster filters 50 gallons of water per day. Imagine what a massive reef of those could do for our systems. It also aids in shoreline stabilization. We can recruit some seagrasses in there. It serves as great habitat for juvenile fishes. It's just a win-win across the board. He collects his oyster shells from wholesalers, restaurants, and from the public. And the Oyster Fest that we have in April, all those shells go to this program, so get out there and eat some oysters, everybody. We'll talk about some of the new initiatives that we have now. St. Lucie County has partnered with the City of Port St. Lucie to complete a microbial source tracking study. This is similar to the one that was completed for the South Fork by Martin County and FDEP. We're doing 6 sampling events. We're halfway through it. We test 3 in the wet season, 3 in the dry season. And the goal is really to identify where the wastewater plumes are significant and the amount of treated versus untreated wastewater. We're testing for human DNA and bird DNA so we can differentiate if we find some fecal coliform or some other kinds of bacteria in there, we can actually determine, is it human-based or is it not? We're testing for sucralose, which is Splenda, and acetaminophen, or Tylenol, as markers to identify human wastewater. Sucralose passes through the wastewater treatment process completely unaffected. So if you pick that up, that would tell you you have treated or untreated wastewater. Acetaminophen does break down in the wastewater process, so if you find that, you may have some untreated wastewater. So based on the ratio of those two or the presence of either of those two, you can begin to identify where your greatest areas of need are. So what we're talking about here is septic tanks, but more importantly, what we're talking about is using a science-based and data-driven approach to make intelligent decisions about things that will affect our citizenry. And this is something that my stormwater program coordinator, Jason Bessie, has been working on for a while now. This is our retrofit program. This sucker up here is called a solar bee. This is a mechanical aerator powered by solar power, and it has a spinning disc just below the surface that serves to aerate the water. This is much like, for those of you who have fish tanks, those diffusion stones or a bubbler that helps to oxygenate the water and turn it over. This does a couple of things. One, it reduces algal growth by keeping the good and the bad algae in check, but it also allows for a mixing effect to take place. So we're going to couple this with a polyacrylamide flocculant to help pull those sediments together and ring it with aquatic plants to help pull those sediments and those nutrients out of the lakes. So our goals are to submit this to the DEP for a proof of concept and see if we can get some additional gains on the areas that we already own. This is far cheaper and far faster than trying to do a capital project from scratch. So speaking of the areas that we already own, I will turn it over now to Mike.
Good evening, everybody. How are you doing this evening? Well, thank you, Patrick, for the intro, and Howard, thank you very much for inviting us to speak this evening as staff for the Environmental Lands Program. We're kind of talking about new territory for this program and the fact that the county was very focused since 1994 into purchasing the land, and we've kind of moved into this management phase. So as part of the management phase, we're looking at restoration and invasive plant management, all these things that go along with owning these very big parcels of land in the county that are environmentally sensitive. So I'm going to be talking about the future kind of with the program, but really I kind of got to touch back on how the program got started. And so in 1994, the voters of St. Lucie County and the citizens voted for a tax referendum bond to purchase these conservation lands in the county. So the bond, it raised nearly it did raise $20 million, but we nearly tripled that number and that resource, that funding resource, with going after grants and other state acquisition programs and kind of coupling those together. And what we were left with purchasing nearly 10,000 acres of conservation land in the county. So talking about land management, I'm with the Environmental Resources Department, and part of our goals is land stewardship. So we're talking about all forms of management for these properties, public access, the public passive recreation side of things, habitat management, your site improvements, your restoration, resource protection. We have a lot of historical resources in the county, but we also have educational components and outreach to get people in tune with nature in St. Lucie County. So really where we tie into all of this with stormwater is the land. So when you're talking about surface waters and restoration in the county, you really do need land when you're talking about STAs, reservoirs, or whether it's stormwater ponds. You need that attenuation. And I just wanted to show this slide, and all the green is the public lands that we own in St. Lucie County. And the public lands is not just St. Lucie County. These are the state preserves, the city preserves. But it's a testament to this county and the citizens of this county and how environmentally conscious we are. And looking to the west, I'm going to be focusing on a couple different projects and just key in on them because I have some really good historical examples of how wet our county was before things started to change in the 1900s. And I will be focusing on some of the properties in western St. Lucie County. So we're looking at, those are your big chunks of acreage that the county owns. So some of these parcels are 3,000 acres, like Bluefield Preserve down here in the lower corner. And then we have McCarty Ranch with the city of Port St. Lucie. Some of these other parcels the county owns, you know, upwards are 800 acres in the western part of the county. And then we'll also be talking about some of the properties that we own on the St. Lucie North Fork and Tamal Creek. So natural area storage, really, to me, it's kind of a tomato-tomato thing. It is, you're using a natural area to store water, but really we're talking about restoration of the wetlands in the natural areas. So we have all this great native upland, and that's what the bond really focused on buying, is really healthy native ecosystems in our county. But part of that, you know, looking at the history, involves the water. We don't have the water. We're losing the water every day on these natural areas. So really, you kind of goes hand in hand to have that healthy ecosystem. You got to have both. So we're looking at wetland restoration and then also some of the floodplain projects that we have on the river. And you really can't talk about restoration without talking about the ecological history that we have in the county. And a lot of this is easily forgotten through the course of time because things happen so fast here. And really, St. Lucie County is, especially Western St. Lucie County, is in such a unique position as far as where the headwaters of the Everglades started. Truly, the water, the wetland swamp that was in Western St. Lucie County, south of Orange Avenue, could be called the headwaters of the Everglades. It's just, if you look at the old aerials and the old maps, you can really see it. And these areas would be referred to in older maps as the Allapatioca Swamp or Allapata Flats now most people are familiar with. And you'll see those names at different high schools and in Martin County. And Martin County was a part of this wetland system. But to the north of Orange Avenue, the other unique feature about the county was that north of Orange Avenue was the headwaters for the St. John's River. So really, if you're looking at, you know, the 1800s before all these drainage projects came into Florida, one could get in a canoe in Miami-Dade and get all the way up through St. Lucie County into the St. John's River and then all the way up to the Jacksonville area. So on the right, the color photographs is the present day Everglades. And you have an open wetland marsh system with sawgrass and tree islands. Corresponding to the left side, the black and white photos, these are 1944 aerials of Western St. Lucie County. And what I want to point out is these dark areas is water. It's a deep marsh system throughout the county, and this is after the drainage had started, so you can imagine how deep this water truly was before the drainage. And these upland areas are shown in the white-gray areas along each photograph. Sorry, the mouse is moving that. So looking at south of State Road 70 in our county, talking about Allapata Flats, you have Cypress Swamp to the west and to the north, and that led into the St. John's River. But Allapata Flats primarily, even though it did reach beyond State Road 70, was kind of started to be cut off in 1944. And 1944 are the earliest aerial photographs that we have of the county. So we have really great maps up until that point, but the aerial photographs really tell us, you know, what was here. And we were kind of lucky that some of the drainage projects got a little late start when you compare to some of the stuff in South Florida. You look at 1944 of Fort Lauderdale, and you don't see these water resources. They're not as evident to us. So in Allapata Flats, it was a sheet flow in Western St. Lucie County, headed south towards the Everglades. And the area I'm going to be talking about is in this red box, Teague Hammock Preserve. We'll get to that area. So in came the canals, and Patrick touched on that. The drainage districts were starting up, and the big canals really pretty much encircled the northern part of Allapata Flats in St. Lucie County. So really, we had a sheet flow going south and a sheet flow going north, but the sheet flow in Allapata Flats was redirected to the east, to our St. Lucie River estuary. And so to highlight this at Teague Hammock Preserve, because it's a great example, we'll zoom in. So this is Stephen J. Fosick Preserve. It encompasses three parcels that the county owns for conservation land. Teague Hammock is the eastern portion. It's 300 acres. It's this red rectangular area highlighted in yellow. And the thing to note in this progression of aerials that I have here for you is the highlighted tree islands, which are now hammocks now, though we call them prairie hammocks. If you watch that and we go fast forward into 1952, eight years, that water is gone. This property was ready for agriculture in 8 years or less. This is, you know, we're draining the properties for cattle and for agriculture uses, citrus, you name it, the things that you're accustomed to seeing in Western St. Lucie County. In a relatively short period of time, I mean, less than 100 years, our Western County was totally changed. So where do we go from here? Well, you have, in 2016, the county owns the property. A lot of the ecological features are there, and we purchased it because it is still environmentally significant. Our uplands, these prairies are some of the most unique, the prairie hammocks are some of the most unique hammocks that I've seen in this area. We're kind of on that verge of northern Florida and southern Florida, so we get a really good progression of tropical hardwoods, but also northern hardwoods. You'll find strangler figs, which you'll find down in southern Florida, but you'll also find American elm trees here. It's really, really unique. So a lot of the topography and the natural features are still intact, but we're minus the water. And that's the problem that we're kind of facing as far as management and restoration, is we still have all these drainage impairments on the property, and it's taking the water away. So, you know, this lecture series is called Listen to the Water. Well, we're at Environmental Resources, we're listening to the land, and we need the water. So that's just from 2016 to 1944. Big change. And here's a quick aerial photograph of the same property, Teague Hammock. That green area was the lush wetland system that you saw in the dark in the black and white photos, and the trees in the background are the hammocks that still remain, the true tree islands that were in western St. Lucie County. The green is pasture grass, so it's very dry there. That grass was planted for cattle, and much of the property's use prior to conservation had cattle operations on the site. So part of the progression of rehydrating this property will be to remove this invasive grass, the torpedo grass. So that's kind of a good example of some of the challenges we have in western St. Lucie County. So moving east to 10 Mile Creek and to the headwaters of our estuary, we're looking at the St. Lucie River North Fork. We own a lot of property on 10 Mile Creek and the North Fork, fortunately. And looking at this old rendering, so this is even before 1944, this is 1919. It's a rendering of 10 Mile Creek coming through here and 5 Mile Creek over here, and then the North Fork kind of snaking down below here. And what's unique about these old images, and it shows how many bends and turns and twists and oxbows and just how different our creeks and rivers were in this area. Now, the red area shown here is a parcel that the county owns. It's called Richard E. Becker Preserve. It's a 13-acre site. And if you notice, part of the old river course came right through the property. So shortly after 1919 and the development of the drainage districts, the creek and the river was channelized. It was basically just straightened out. That helped drainage. That helped, you know, move things through the water. Helped a lot of things of things needed at that time. But it impaired the waterway kind of forever. And so looking today at the parcel, this is a LIDAR image. It's basically a topographic laser image of the property. You can see all the floodplain remaining in 10 Mile Creek around our property. And what to note is the oxbows. These old river courses are still here, but a lot of them are plugged up. They're plugged up along the channel. So basically when they came through and dredged it straight, they just piled the spoil on the edge and it blocked all these old channels off. So if you've watched Dr. Gilmore's presentation in the other lecture series, one of the things that he pointed out was that the invasive and non-native fish are using these large channeled areas, and our native, more important fish for like ecotourism and the economy, such as tarpon and snook, they use these other little flowways off the channel for nursery habitat. So they're very critical. So what can we do here? Well, it really just entails removing a lot of these blockages, and that's really what we'd be focused on. But there's a lot to do with it because we have so much infrastructure and neighborhoods and things around our projects that it requires a lot of permitting and a lot of effort and engineering, and moving dirt from a riverine area is very difficult and very costly. So what other options? These are more focused on the properties in western St. Lucie County. The types of options you have with rewatering a site like Teague Hammock Preserve is, really you got to take away the drainage, the factors that take the water away. So, plug and fill the ditches. In some instances where your water table is so far, like if you're really close to a canal, you can scrape down and access that water table. You can also pump and rewater. They use this a lot down in South Florida because of the challenges they face down there. And ultimately what you find, like in the photographs here, the before and after, just adding the water is enough to bring the natives back and the herps and all the other aquatic organisms that you need here in this environment. And that's an old cypress dome, so you can really clearly see that it's flourishing once you bring the water back. So this is just another example of pumping into the wetlands in South Florida. It is an option here, but I do think we can get away with just moving a lot of the dirt in-house, and there's a lot of cost savings that we'll have. We won't have to install a lot of costly pumps and such, but it's a pretty unique project. They basically, you survey the lowest parts of the old wetlands, you bring the pumps into the lowest point, and then there's a float system that basically triggers when the water starts to drop down, it turns the pump back on. And so the water is always constantly being added to the wetland. And you can set the floats to mimic the natural hydro periods of rain and drought periods, which is very important for species like cypress trees, where when they drop their seeds, they need that inundation period to soften the seed, but then a dry period to take hold in the soils. So benefits of water storage in natural areas, we're really talking about the byproducts of wetland restoration. So yes, you're doing water storage, and it's great, and what is the estuary getting too much of? It's getting too much of the fresh water, but what are we limited on? We're limited on water in the natural areas. So the other byproducts of restoring the wetlands on the St. Lucie County lands is, you're getting natural area that's natural filtering the water. You're getting slower releases that will help with the things that Patrick mentioned, the BMAPs and the TMDLs and those state mandates, because it'll help recharge our groundwater. And it also reduces nutrients in the system by holding water back on the lands. But this land, it's not engineered to take the water like for an engineering project like stormwater or a STA. This land is naturally adapted for the water, so that's why it's important. So looking ahead, this is new territory for the county. Like I said, we just purchased a lot of these lands in the last several years, but looking ahead for management, we have a lot of conceptual projects with a lot of impaired wetlands. So we do think there's a lot of acreage in the county that we can focus on rewatering and bringing the water back. And I mentioned Teeb Hammock. This is a list of 12 projects. Becker's on here. Just a few other ones for you. And looking ahead, there's some other projects in Western St. Lucie County that, can be associated to the private sector and the private landowner, the water farming. And I know Patrick will be speaking towards that in the rest of the presentation.
Thank you, Mike. So I got to move through real quickly and just give a tip of the hat to my staff that really does the day-to-day work of some of the functions of the Water Quality Division. We have 540 miles of roadway in the county. About 500 of those miles are rural, so that is an open swale type of system. Those swales silt in, they eventually get to a point where they need to be mechanically cleaned, regrassed, and set back to their original elevations. That's one of our big functions. We also do illicit discharge investigation. What is illicit discharge? It is basically anytime somebody's plumbing their septic tank or their washing machine or their backwash for their water softener out into the swales and discharging sediment and water in an area that it shouldn't go. So we report those. We also do drainage investigations for private citizens to help them identify the root cause of where they may be having a problem. Grounds maintenance. This sucker here, this is pump number 2, getting pulled out of Indian River State's pump station. There's a roof hatch for access to each of these pumps. Found out that there was some lumber, some filter fabric, and a PVC pipe wrapped around the bearing there that was preventing the pump from turning over. So keep those things out of the swale, guys. We got water sampling that we do every 3 weeks. We test Indian River Estates. We test Platts Creek. Of course, we do driveway permitting, stormwater permitting, and land development regulation. Some of the larger aspects, not directly associated with my division so much, but the county passed a fertilizer ordinance in 2014, which helped to create setbacks from surface waters, helped to identify levels of nitrogen, slow-release nitrogen, and some blackout dates that we placed on there. We partner with UF to train some commercial and our applicators and homeowners. We recently got involved with the Be Floridian Now initiative, which helps to give the message of smart fertilizer use to homeowners. Hugely successful in the Tampa Bay area for their estuary. They will have a booth at this weekend's Indian River Lagoon Science Fest, so please come and check them out. We also manage the floodplain protection ordinance, which helps to manage the natural functions of the floodplain and keeps regulation for the uses of that floodplain, and it actually helps to lower flood insurance rates through our county. And of course, we have partnerships with the Indian River Lagoon National Estuary Program and the St. Lucie River Issues Team, both of which are entities that help to pull down grant funds from various state and federal sources for projects right here in our backyard. Some of the other initiatives that have been hugely successful from a leadership standpoint, our commission was successful in the deauthorization of the 10 Mile Creek project, the STA that was originally a Army Corps project, and helped to turn that over to the Water Management District, which is actually going to do a project that will put that system into operation this year to store at least a component of what it was originally designed for. I mentioned Platts Creek and Indian Hills with our local partners. Keep lobbying and advocating for Everglades restoration, Central Everglades Planning Project, and the IRL South, making sure that those don't fall to the bottom of the list, because in actuality, they're tremendously necessary and their readiness state is far higher than some of the other projects around here. I mentioned the weekly calls with the Army Corps for the Lake Okeechobee management. And as Mike touched on, the proven water farming projects in our local areas. We have large landowners with a lot of fallow citrus out there. These are their farming areas. They're perfectly set up to hold and store water and either let it percolate into the ground or evaporate off rather than just having it flow through our natural systems. And the public side can, or the private side can do it cheap and inexpensively, a little bit easier than the public side sometimes can. And of course, we have our land development code and our comp plan that helps to keep regulations on new uses and other areas where we identify that may have some elements coming into our system that weren't previously thought about or monitored. I mentioned the TMDL and the BMAP development. Next week is the annual meeting for the BMAP, so that's where all the entities come in and identify which projects are working on or completed to try to keep this as a living document. And of course, we have the fantastic facility of the Oxbow Eco Center down there off of St. James Drive. So go and visit if you've not already done so. It is quite the place to go. So we'll take this moment of zen with this beautiful picture to say thank you. I'll turn it back over to Howard Tipton now for our closeout. Thank you.
Give Patrick and Mike a round of applause. They did a great show. It's not easy to do those things, and it obviously took a lot of time and effort and a lot of historical digging to kind of pull all that picture together. But it really talks about, you know, we kind of walk into these places and we think about that it's always been this way. And in Florida in particular, that's not the case at all. There's very little that we can actually recognize from even 50, 60 years ago. We've just gone in and dramatically changed our environment. Again, the reasons, you know, can't do anything about those, you know, a lot of commercial interest way back when. But we have this opportunity now to do something about it and to at least create awareness. And so there's two parts to this part of the program. And I'm going to just talk for a second about, let me see if I can just get this up here. They always move these things around on you. I want to talk a little bit about a sales tax initiative that is before the voters for this coming election, November the 8th. And I mention it, this isn't a hard sell, it's not even a soft sell. I actually can't sell this. I can just inform you about it. But one of the things that Patrick and Mike and the rest of our team and so many folks from the community have talked about is how can we do a better job of keeping up with our maintenance responsibilities. You know, we saw the corrugated metal pipes. Something about putting corrugated metal pipes in salty soil, not a good combination. They have a limited lifespan. It's a cheap way to go. We know why we did it way back when, but those pipes just collapse. And so not only do they collapse and it blocks the flow of water, but they create some fairly dangerous road conditions as well. And so we are coming to the end of the useful life of a lot of the things that we have put in the ground over these many years. I had a chance to attend my grandmother's funeral last year. She lived to be almost 101. And as I was doing research to speak at her service, one of the things that was interesting, in the same year that she was born, the very first traffic signal was installed. So think about that. How many millions of traffic signals are there in the United States? And when she was born, that was the first year. So in the last, actually, 125 years, we've installed more infrastructure than in the history of the world prior to that. And it all gets older, and it all ages. And so the challenge is that we've got to try to maintain it. And we're not doing a great job with it. And so I am here to share that story with you very briefly, and to share that there's an opportunity to think about at least one approach. So between the county and the cities, we have identified over the next 20 years about a $1.2 billion backlog in infrastructure projects. And we talk about infrastructure, it's building things and buying things, but it's not operating things. So we're talking about roads and road repaving, we're talking about stormwater, we're talking about sidewalks. Those are the things that we're talking about. The Board of County Commissioners decided to put a half cent of additional sales tax on the ballot for November the 8th. It goes to the issues I just talked about. We're working together on these issues. We actually had unanimous votes of support from both Port St. Lucie and Fort Pierce to join us in putting this out. And that's unusual, because you may have read that from time to time we don't get along. But we are absolutely together on this issue. One of the things that's a benefit of using a sales tax is that 20-25% of it is paid for by visitors. These are the same visitors that are coming here and join our community, and we have the opportunity to maybe not put it all on the back of the property taxpayers, but actually get the visitors to help pay for it. There's a sunset provision in this deal, and so that was important. One of these, you know, we've all been and seen things that kind of go on forever. There's a 20-year sunset provision on this initiative, and we picked 20 years because of the amount of time it takes to really make a difference when you're dealing with these large infrastructure projects. For some of the larger road projects, it can take 12-15 years to get those things done. And so we needed a long horizon in order to really make a difference. The other important feature that's been built into this, and it's in the language that you'll see on the ballot, is that there's a citizen oversight committee. And their primary charge is going to be making sure that these dollars go for additional projects. So anybody here in Florida when the lottery was passed, anybody remember that? So what happened? The lottery was going to be additional money for the education system. And instead, the legislature, in their infinite wisdom, because all wisdom flows from Tallahassee, they took that money and put it into other pots. And so what you had is lottery money becoming the education funding. And so we don't want to be a part of that. Nobody wants to be a part of that. So these are additional dollars that are coming in. And so this Citizens Oversight Committee is charged to make sure that if I'm not here or we have got new commissioners, that these dollars are for new projects. They're not going to go and replace a capital program that we already have existing in our public works street repaving program. So these are additional dollars for additional projects. And it's lucky number 7 on the ballot. So we talked about what it's going for: water quality, public safety. When we talk about public safety, we've got some sheriff's vehicles that we're looking at, also the 800 megahertz radio system. We're currently at 6.5%, so the state sets it at 6% for every county in the state. There's 67 counties. We have a half cent currently additional to that that goes for the school system, and that goes for their school capital projects. So we'd be talking about taking it from 6.5% to 7%. Currently, Brevard County has a referendum on their ballot to take their sales tax to 7%. Indian River's already at 7%. Okeechobee's at 7%, Martin's at 6%, Palm Beach and Broward counties are going to 7% if their initiatives are successful. This applies only to the first $5,000 of a purchase, and this is consistent with all sales tax applications. So if you were going to go out and buy a $20,000 car, it only adds $25 to the cost of that vehicle. So it's capped at the first $5,000. I mentioned that it sunsets after 20 years. It can only be reauthorized by another vote of the people. It's not something that a city council or the county commissioners can do on their own. It must be reauthorized. As I mentioned, it's used for building things and buying things like land, but it cannot be used for operating things. So no salaries, no administrative costs get tagged into this. This is just really for other projects. Estimated revenue right now comes in at just under $16 million, and we will be using the state allocation formula for that, where the county gets about half of that, and then the cities split it based on population and a few other factors. And what's nice about these dollars is that they can be used to leverage other dollars. And so Mike talked about the success that we had with our preservation program, where we took $20 million and turned it into $75 million. We think we can do that with these road dollars as well, with these water dollars as well. There's lots of opportunities for grants from both federal, state, but also some partnerships with our city partners and water management districts and a whole bunch of other folks. And so it's an opportunity to leverage those dollars. For all of us, I think we're pretty familiar with the Taylor Creek discharge into our pristine waters there. And it's just not good. It's not good at all. We've got a second shot here, kind of looking down, and you can see that dark plume coming in. And if not for that twice daily flushing by the inlet, it'd be a lot worse for us. That's not necessary. We don't have to have that black water coming out. We can fix that. Talking with Mike Adams at the Water Control District, there's a fix for that. It's not inexpensive. It's about $500,000, but there's a fix for that. And so we can do a better job just on one of our primary discharges there on the north side. We've talked about a lot of the different projects, and I won't spend a lot of time talking about it, but reclaiming a lot of the damage that was done by basically straight lining all the water out is a big task. And we've, I think, had some great success with Indian Hills, with Platts Creek, Howard's Creek, the Veterans Memorial. There's a lot of examples of ways that we are kind of replumbing nature, kind of giving it back its chance to get healthy and get us healthy. I just wanted to share with you that the county has some projects here. I won't go into each one, but basically the cost over the next 5 years for these projects from 2018 through 2022, we've identified $14.7 million worth of costs for these projects. We've identified $431,000 in funding. That's what we have. So we're only short $14.2 million. And so when we talk about our inability to really address some of these infrastructure issues, I think that's a pretty telling statement. Our team and Eric Gill and Ruben Dye and a whole bunch of our folks have worked together to create a very informative website. It's called slchalfcent.com, and it's all about the sales tax. So it has frequently asked questions. It's got interactive maps, so you can kind of hover over your house or your area of the county and kind of see what projects that we're going to be talking about. It's one of the best websites I've seen done by professionals, consultants, or staff, and I'm just so proud of our team for doing that. So that's all I can share with you about that. I can't tell you to support it. All I can do is tell you that we have a need, and this has been identified as an option to address that need. Happy to answer any questions after the program is done, but what we do ask is that, you know, let's make sure that we exercise our right as citizens to get out and vote. No matter what the issues, no matter how you feel, that's an important part of our democracy. It's an important part of our heritage, and we want to make sure that we preserve that and pass that on. So with that, I'm going to say thank you, and I'm going to bring up Ed. Ed Skavarch Jr. is our newly installed director for our Extension Office, which is a partnership between the University of Florida and and each of the counties. And I couldn't be more proud of him and the energy that he's bringing to our program and kind of what's on the horizon, just as I'm proud of Mike and Patrick and Sandy and the rest of our team, because we've got a lot of people who are very committed to our community, and the future's bright for us. So please welcome Ed Skovarch.
So Howard, thank you for the nice introduction. You too. Fabulous, absolutely, really. I love all that historical stuff. So, and what you're doing is just an incredible job. And what I would like to talk to everybody today about is some of the personal responsibilities that they can take in their own yards by bringing to you some of the Florida-friendly concepts that we, through the university, have researched for a number of years, and we go out and do educational programs. So when we look at some of these concepts, the first one I want to discuss is water efficiency. When you're watering your yard, if you have a watering system that's in there, what you want to be able to do is to understand when your yard needs to be watered. Now, there may be times where your blades of grass maybe are starting to fold up a little, and you can go ahead and manually water them then. A second way is by on your timers, putting in either a half of an inch or 3/4 of an inch of water per week, depending on how much rain has been in the yard, and also by installing a rain shutoff device, which will override the system. Now, some of the other ways of doing that is by going ahead and purchasing or just putting in a simple water gauge in your yard. This one here, you turn off your sprinklers, you see it around 3/4 of an inch, you turn off your sprinklers. So if whoever asks us a good question at the end of the night, Sandy will hand this out as a door prize. We also want to reduce stormwater runoff. We can reduce stormwater runoff in a number of ways in our yards by taking our downspouts and instead of having them run the water off onto pavement, have them run off to turf grass or having them run off into your ornamental beds. I had a short conversation with a nice couple over here. I just happened to meet them. They're on North Hutchinson Island, North Pig Island, and they live on the waterfront. And so when you're looking at protecting the waterfront, what you wanted to do at a very minimum is to create a 10-foot buffer zone between where you're going to mow your lawn, where you're going to apply fertilizer if you're going to be doing that, or if you're going to be applying any pesticides, so that portion of your lawn can absorb those nutrients and additional runoff. Oh, look at that. Okay. So what you want to do is fertilize carefully. If you're going to fertilize, you're going to look at some of the rates that are on your bag of fertilizer. Calculate those out. Patrick talked about a fertilizer ordinance during the beginning of June through the end of September. You're not allowed to apply fertilizer with any nitrogen in it. During the entire course of the year, you're not allowed to apply any fertilizer with phosphorus in it. If you are going to apply fertilizer, you want to use at the very minimum 50%, and if you can look at 60 or 70% slow release, then that's much better. Be good to your swale, as Patrick mentioned. What the engineers want to do is they want to get that first inch of rain off of the roadway. That's probably the most treacherous time. You have oils from brake dust or from cars, transmission oil, motor oil that builds up on that surface, and it becomes very slick very quickly. So what you want to do is take that water and get it off of your roads and get it into your swale. Your swales are designed to be able to filter out that first inch of water and then gradually pass the water along to your storm retention or detention ponds. So when we ask you to be good to your swale, don't pile up some of your lawn debris, although it's been a little bit difficult lately not to do that. But if you're going to be putting stuff out for garbage pickup, try not to put it out in your swale area. Try not to park in that swale area. All of that will help, will prevent that water from running smoothly off of your off of your landscape. Direct your downspouts on either your ornamental beds or onto your grass. Maintain your septic system. If you have a septic system, look at maintaining that every 3 years or so. If you have some mechanical pumps and things like that, you might want to look at maintaining those every year. Check your vehicles for leaks, oil, transmission oil, things like that. And pick up after your pets. So I come with a prop tonight. You want to invest in the Indian River Lagoon? Well, this is going to cost you about 5 cents right here. If you're lucky, maybe 6 cents, right? So what you do is you, of course, you're going to put your hand in this. And everyone knows that everyone appreciates a clean environment, right? And you get a little exercise by bringing this down and picking this up. So this is a poopy glove, a poopy puppy glove. And if you live in a homeowners association, I've seen some of these associations up in the Gainesville area. Well, they'll have areas where you can pick these up. So we're out at the extension. We can help you hopefully with that project if you are in a homeowner association, and get involved. This is the most important thing. Get involved in your community. It's your community. You're the stakeholders. In the end, when we go to work to be able to help you out. So get involved. Volunteer if you can. We have wonderful Master Gardener volunteers out at our office. There's so many opportunities for you to be a part of the solution, and we all need to be. And finally, and this isn't on here, but not only do you want to listen to the water, but listen to the science. You've had so many brilliant scientists up here talking about some of the problems and some of the solutions. Listen to the science. And that's it for me.